Different reason afterwards, but Boise State just two losses in their last 66 home games. Coach Peterson said it felt like a bowl game. Now, they did this pregame handshake. The postgame handshake would not go off so seamlessly. Second quarter scoreless. Kellen Moore, who last year threw for the third most yards in FBS history by a freshman to Austin Pettis. They scored a two-point conversion. Also, Oregon's defense, not even in the ballgame. It was Thursday night football. Oregon acted like they thought it was supposed to be Saturday football. Second quarter, Jeremiah Masoli hands off to LeGarrette Blount. He runs east-west. No, that doesn't work. It's a safety. Boise State up 13-10 at the half. And frankly, the game wasn't that close. This Oregon team, 485 yards they averaged in offense last year. That was tops in the Pac-10. They had 14 yards in the first half and held the ball for less than 6 minutes. Lucky to be only down 13. Chip Kelly, the new man, he was the offensive coordinator, replacing Mike Bellotti. All right, he gets him going in the second half. Masoli in. Oregon gets a two-point conversion. It's 19-8. Here with about 12 minutes left, Oregon with a chance to keep it interesting. Blount stops short of the first down. Boise State going to win the game 19-8. Now, after the game, the Broncos are celebrating, as would be expected. They extend their home game win streak to 50. That fellow right there, Byron Hout, said something to Blount, and Blount said something back with his fist. Dropped him with one punch. Blount did a lot of talking before this game, frustrated during the game, and in big trouble after the game. Behavior that's unacceptable at any level, and he's walking off, the fans getting on him, and Blount goes after them. Oregon coaching staff and the security there trying to hold Blount back, and just an ugly ending. Chip Kelly's first game, not what he hoped for on or off the field.
I didn't see it. You know, I saw their offensive line coach from Boise did a great job of separating everybody. I grabbed LeGarrette, got him to one of our coaches, and then I was really looking for Pete just to congratulate him after the game. So, you know, I've been asked the question before in the post-game press conference. You know, we'll review the thing and we'll take appropriate action. But, you know, as I told our players in the locker room, that, you know, we have to learn to play with emotion and not let emotion play with us. And that is not Oregon University. That's not the University of Oregon. That's not the way we play football. And we don't condone any of that.
Have you had a chance to talk one-on-one with LeGarrette Blount since it happened?
No. I've been run through the ringer since this thing ended. So, you know, I'll get a chance to visit with him on the ride home and talk about the situation. And we'll get to the bottom of it.
Well, you don't want to walk into Boise in Idaho and take on the Broncos on that blue stuff. Or I don't think it matters that the turf's blue. I just think they've got a heck of a football program.
It can be plaid the way they play.
Yeah. 65-2 at home since 1999. That is the best in the FBS, even better than they do down there at Norman, Oklahoma. After the game, Boise State's Chris Peterson.
You know, just emotions getting the best of players. And, you know, hey, it was a hard-fought game. Really proud of our defense. You know, typical first game, a lot of sloppy football, but I thought our defense rose to the occasion and played great.
Coach, before kick, you certainly had to say all the right things surrounding all the hype, but now that the game's over, now that the Broncos have won, can you measure the importance of this game?
Well, it's just one of 13. It really is. And next week is, you know, just as important as this week. We've been saying it all.
North Carolina State in Raleigh. Gamecocks won 34-0 last year in this matchup. Tony Baker coughs it up. Devin Taylor with a strip. Gamecocks recover at the NC State 14. They would punch it in for a touchdown. Then later, Steven Garcia looking for Tony Gurley. That appears to be a touchdown, but it's called back. Offensive pass interference on the play. Look, Gurley with a slight push on Wilson. And Steve Spurrier says, you can fight for it. Can't pull him down. 46 seconds left of the half. Russell Wilson, All-ACC last year, the first freshman to make it to the first team All-ACC as a quarterback. Long throw to Jarvis Williams, but he can't hang on. NC State's longest first half play was 7 yards. Fourth quarter, 7-3. Tom O'Brien needs his team to do something. Wilson to Jay Smith, but he can't hang on. Missed opportunity for NC State. They had only 133 yards of offense. You know, they say this time of year, defenses are still ahead of the offenses, and I think that's what we saw in both of the marquee games on Thursday night. And Wilson, later in the drive, 4th and 11. Stephon Gilmore knocks that one away. South Carolina goes on to win it 7-3. They held the Wolfpack to 59 yards on 31 carries on the ground.
State. Utah's won 14 straight games, 8 straight bowl games. Those are the best streaks going anywhere. But Brian Johnson, no longer the quarterback. He's gone. He finished his career with a school record 26 career wins. Last season, nearly 3,000 yards and 27 touchdowns. So who are you going to replace him with? Well, Terrence Cain. Utah's second possession, and Cain is able. He finds David Reed on the slant, and Reed's got reservations for 6.
Great block.
65 yards. In fact, Stan, let's take a look at those blocks right there, because, you know, we got to go inside, and it's John Peel and Iona Key. Booming, booming. Reed easily into the end zone. Next Utah possession, Cain. Peel made the good block. Now I'm going to find you. Slant, 22 yards. Utah up 14-3. And then they call this the Asiata formation. Matt Asiata, the direct snap into the end zone. He finished with a career-high 156 yards on 36 carries. He had 2 touchdowns. Utah wins.
The end conference USA action. Tulsa opens the season with 3 straight road games. First of them in the Superdome against Tulane. Tulane hasn't had a winning season since 2002. Maybe this is why.
What's wrong with Tulane and their winning ways, their lack of winning?
What's
their famous victory bell, it doesn't have a clapper inside it. It doesn't make any noise.
Really?
So if they win, nobody can hear it.
And there's a disappointed crowd in the Superdome, too. Nobody can hear them either. First quarter, Tulane down 10-0. Joe Kemp picked off. Mike Bryan takes it down to the Tulane 5. Tulsa will score in the next play. Green Wave trail 20-3 at the half. During the game, Tulane getting support from a famous alumnus. Running back Matt Forte tweeted, "My Tulane Green Wave is playing the Tulsa, whatever they are. I hope they win so I can brag. It's the Golden Hurricane." But the support would not help. Fourth quarter, Tulsa's Damaris Johnson, rather, takes Tulane punt at his own 34. And he's directing traffic on his way to the end zone. 66 yards for the touchdown. And Tulsa rolls. 1 down, 2 to go to start the season on the road. 37-13, the final.